Good morning. Welcome to Faith Community Christian Reformed Church on this beautiful Sunday, this Lord's Day, where we can come and gather. It is Palm Sunday today, as many of you know, the triumphal entry of Jesus. We celebrate that today into Jerusalem, and we give thanks that he made his way straight to the cross and had been doing that his entire ministry and life. So we're glad of what our Savior has done for us. Welcome to those who are worshiping with us, our members here, and those who are frequently attending, and others too. We're glad you are here as guests. I know a few of you probably are here for the Kingdom Seekers, who will kind of begin the service in a bit, and then also for the Professions of Faith and baptism coming up later in the service. So thanks for coming, and welcome. You're welcome here anytime. After the service, we do have a time of refreshment. It is, I believe, downstairs today, not in the narthex, but downstairs, kind of a reception for those who are professing faith and also those who are being welcomed today as well. Just a reminder to, or I should say hello to those who are worshiping on live stream as well. Thanks for tuning in that way today. Then evening service tonight at 5:30 p.m. We're looking at part two of this morning's message, so come again this evening. And then also a few prayer concerns to keep before you in addition to what you see in your bulletins. Steve Miller, some of you know he has not been feeling well. He's been very fatigued, and he did, in fact, have some blood tests that came back abnormally, so they did give him a CAT scan and a PET scan with some concerns there, so he's waiting for results for those, so be in prayer for him and for Donna as well. And then also Kathy Ponstein, we heard from son Jack this week, late in the week, that, well, she's under hospice care at Sunset Manor, but she's been declining fairly quickly of late, so please keep Kathy in your prayers and her entire family as well in this time. Then we want to welcome a new family to our church. If Reverend Cedric and Bryna Parcells would stand, that'd be great. They're right here in the front row. See, I didn't plan that. They just did that. So welcome, Cedric and Bryna, and your daughters. Oh, wow, they're already clapping. And your daughters are getting ready with Kingdom Seekers, right? Aurelia and Daphne and Elena. Cedric is an ordained minister in the Christian Reformed Church. Bryna is a Spanish teacher and award-winning chicken chili maker. And daughter Elena is a fantastic cornhole player, also an award winner. All right? That may have been right here that they may have won those awards. So they're joining us from Door CRC and live out that way as well. So we're going to greet them also. If you could make your way downstairs after the service and we mill about a little bit so we can greet you that way. So let's give them another round of applause. Okay. Well, friends, it is the sixth Sunday in Lent, what we know as Palm Sunday. Since it's sixth Sunday of Lent, why don't you stand and greet one another? Then I'll do the Lord's blessing, and then we'll hear a little bit of scriptures. Greet six people, okay? And now, congregation, we've greeted each other, but the greeting that we all look forward to each Sunday is from the Lord, right? And he is the one who greets us, and just after this, we'll also hear words of the triumphal entry as Christy reads them for us. Listen to these words of greeting first. Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ, through the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, let all God's people say, Amen.
Hear from the word of the Lord, Mark 11:1-11. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you doing this?' tell him, 'The Lord needs it and will send it back here shortly.' They went and found a colt outside in the street, tied at a doorway. As they untied it, some people standing there asked, 'What are you doing untying that colt?' They answered as Jesus had told them to, and the people let them go. When they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others spread branches they had cut in the fields. Those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, 'Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest.' Jesus entered Jerusalem and went to the temple. He looked around at everything, but since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12.
People sing, Hosanna,
Well, kids, this is the time when you get to head downstairs for children in worship. So if you could stand up right where you are and hold your hands up to receive God's blessing, that would be great. All right. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you his peace. Let all God's people say, amen. Amen. You may head downstairs. Well, friends, let's spend some time in prayer to our God. Our Father in heaven, we are thankful that we are here, that you woke us up this morning, that you give us life, breath in our lungs, the beat in our heart, and you brought us here. You called us and we came. Thank you for that. Thank you for this opportunity to worship you, to lift high the name of Jesus, to shout our hosannas to you, our praises and our save us, Lords, to you. And thank you for the opportunity to hear our children praise you, to give their praise to you. And thank you for the kingdom seekers and the work that they did all year and the teachers did. We're thankful for them. We're thankful, too, for what we will witness a little later, the professions of faith. We're thankful for Seth and Hope and Cade and Adam and Luke and your work in their lives. And we're thankful that you've brought them to this point where they will say publicly that they love you, that they know you as Savior and Lord. We praise you for that. Our Father, we ask that you would be with us in this day as we worship. We pray that you would bless us, even as we are trying to be a blessing to you, giving praise to you, that you, we know you are blessing us through your Holy Spirit and Word, and we pray that you would transform us into the people you would have us be. And we pray for our world. We pray that you would continue to hold this world in the palm of your hand, that you would be with every place where there is turmoil and bloodshed. We think of the difficulty right now and the terrorism that happened just this past week in Russia. We pray for your grace to abound in the lives of those who've lost loved ones there. We pray for places where the church is persecuted. We think of places like Nigeria, where the Fulani Muslims just see it as their duty to get rid of the Christian population. So bless those followers of Christ. Bless those followers of Christ that they may be true to your word and stay strong in it. Our Father, we are praying for our country. We pray for our president and vice president. We pray that you would bless them, give them wisdom and guidance each day. Our Father, we pray for those in our own congregation. We pray for health and strength and healing and recuperation. We're praying for Gloria Houtsma and Linda DeWinkle, Andy Kloster. We pray that you'd be with them all in their recoveries. We pray for Mary Norden, who anticipates some surgery this week. We pray for Steve Miller, who's waiting tests. Be with him, Donna. We pray for Kathy Ponstein and the Ponstein family in this time to bless them with your grace and strength. And we pray for a friend of Marcia Boaz, dealing with cancer and radiation and chemo. We pray for Stephen Donna Miller's son, Kevin, and the good news that he's had. We pray that that would continue, give him full strength and healing. We pray for Brent Lynam as well, and we pray that his recovery continues to go well. And we pray for our servicemen today and their families. Thank you for them. And Father, you know all these needs. We don't even have to say them aloud. You know the meditations, the cries of our heart, because you know us so well. You see right into our hearts, and you know, too, that we are sinners, and you know each sin that we parade before your face, even though we like to keep it hidden. It's not hidden from you, so forgive us. Forgive us from our sins. Forgive us just as we are determined in our hearts to forgive others. But we know the great forgiveness of the cross won there by Jesus. And so we praise you for that. We praise you that you assure us, tell us that if we confess our sins, that our sins are forgiven, we are cleansed by the blood of Jesus. And then you tell us, now thank me. Thank me in your living and in your words and in your thoughts. Give me thanks. Follow my commands. Follow after my son Jesus. Help us to do that. Remind us that we too have a duty, responsibility to give thanks and to honor you for what you have done for us and to live according to your law and your will. Remind us to love you above all else and all others, and then also remind us to love our neighbors as ourselves. Thank you for the privilege once again of worshiping you. Thank you for each family, each individual, each single person, each child, each adult, young adult, middle-aged, elderly folks here. We pray for each one that you would meet us right where we're at, and you would give us exactly what we need. Perhaps it's comfort on this day. Perhaps it's mercy. Perhaps it's forgiveness and grace. Perhaps it's guidance and wisdom. Perhaps it's a healing of a relationship. Give us what we need, we pray, and help us to ask you for it. And even when we don't even know we need it, we pray that you would provide it and surprise us with the surprise of your grace in our lives. Thrill us with it. Father, bless us as we offer our gifts to you, as we open your word in a few moments. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, friends, our offering is going to be received at this time. It's for the general fund. What does general mean? Well, that's what we call the Kingdom Fund. It's to keep lights on in this place, but it's also for reaching out to our missionaries through our denomination, through our classes, and providing for the ministry of this church. So let's give to the glory of Jesus Christ. You see there's a way to give, a lot of different ways on the screen. The deacons will be passing offering baskets and as we get ready for our offerings. And we're going to be singing during this offering, and we need a minute to set up here. And again, we give for God's glory, that he would be praised, and that Jesus' name would go forth from this place because of what we give, that God would bless it. Deacons, come forward at this time.
We will worship you,
Sovereign King of every nation. We will worship you until the end of endless time. Live to fulfill your true desire. The rocks cry out, we will sing your praise. We will shout the name that sets us free for eternity.
stone of our foundation, we will worship you.
Giver of the one salvation, we will worship you. Until the end of endless days, declare the glory of your ways for eternity. We will worship you, Lord of life and love, we seek your face. And we stand here only by your grace, lest the rocks cry out, we will sing your praise. We will shout the name that sets us free for eternity. For eternity.
Oh, I didn't really know what was next, so I'm a little, start looking up Luke 19, all right? Luke 19:28-40. We've already heard one rendition, if you will, one version of the triumphal entry. We're going to hear another one now. Listen to these words, Luke 19:28-40. After Jesus had said this, he went ahead of them, going up to Jerusalem. As he approached Bethphage and Bethany at the hill called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' say, 'The Lord needs it.' Those who were sent ahead went and found it just as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, 'Why are you untying the colt?' They replied, 'The Lord needs it.' They brought it to Jesus, threw their cloaks on the colt, and put Jesus on it. As he went along, people spread their cloaks on the road. And when he came near the place where the road goes down the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully to praise God in loud voices for all the miracles they had seen. 'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest.' Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, 'Teacher, rebuke your disciples.' 'I tell you,' he replied, 'if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out.'" This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Beloved in Christ, last verse is trying to tell us something important. Jesus is telling us that stones, no mouths, unable to speak, stones might be better tellers of the good news than human beings are. Human beings believe the good news, thankful for it, praise God for it, but stones, if given the chance, would do a better job at telling the good news of Jesus than you or I do. I am simultaneously amazed and embarrassed by that verse. Wow, the good news of Jesus is so incredible that if given the chance, even stones would cry out about it. Amazing. And wow, I'm doing my best to make that kind of miracle happen, and not in a good way. That's the embarrassing part. Me not opening my mouth puts stones in a better position to tell the good news about Jesus. That's embarrassing. To address that embarrassment today, we'll look at the story of Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem. Of course, please take notes. Three columns. Turn the back blank page of your bulletin sideways. Here it is on the screen, too. I did my homework ahead of time. Left column, verse. Middle column, good news message label. And right column, an application, always starting with the word be. Be this, be that, the other thing. Get it? We'll do that 8 times. 4 times this morning at this service. 4 more times at tonight's service, 5:30 p.m. You don't come tonight, you miss half the sermon, you walk around lopsided all week. Come tonight. All 4 renditions of the Palm Sunday triumphal entry story by the end of the day. You already heard 2, but it's in all 4 Gospels. This morning it's the Mark and Luke versions of the story. Here's a quiz for the kids. Which 2 books of the Bible will we look at tonight? Kids, you know this one? What's on either side of Mark and Luke? What are they, kids? Matthew and John. Good job. That's tonight. Mark and Luke right now. Keep your Bibles open. First stop, Mark 11, verse 8. Picture what's happening. Triumphal entry. Crowd of people following Jesus wherever he went, because, well, he healed and saved people, did mighty signs and wonders. So people followed him. As Jesus comes into Jerusalem, the people start celebrating. He is their king. They're convinced. Who else could do the things he was doing? They're shouting, Hosanna, 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 praising this Messiah. Then they do their tradition, something similar to rolling out the red carpet today. We just had that fabulous Academy Awards event a couple of weeks ago. And what do they do for all those stars, those celebrities who are all better than us? They roll out the red carpet. First century Jerusalem, it was more of a dirty ecru-colored carpet. That's how it's always portrayed in the movies. They spread their dirty tan-colored coats or cloaks on the road and on the colt that Jesus was about to ride so the Messiah could come into Jerusalem in style, like a king. Red carpet, ecru carpet rolled out. Who names a color ecru anyway? It's a French word. Go figure. Now, verse 8, many people spread their cloaks on the road while others spread branches, palm branches. Oh, so it's an ecru and green-colored carpet. That's a little nicer. Now, they spread branches that they had cut in the fields. In other words, they had prepared for this, gone out and cut those branches in the field. So one way the message of Messiah got told that day were by these actions. And these actions were intentional. They intentionally went into the fields to cut those branches used for this celebration. The good news message of Jesus, the Messiah, coming is an intentional message. People shouting, Hosanna, spreading their cloaks, going to cut branches. All intentional things spoke a message of good news. The Messiah, our King, has come at last. He's here. He's going to save us from the Roman Empire occupation. The people in their words and actions were intentionally telling the good news. What's the application? May I suggest that it's be deliberate. There's a good news message to be given to touch the word with, and we need to be deliberate about it. That means we're open to what God wants us to do. means praying for an open spirit for us to be used to spread the good news. Means praying specifically that God will bring a person into our lives and that our relationship will get to such a point with that person that God will make an opportunity arise through which we can share our faith. And when he does, we're praying that we will indeed speak up deliberately. As petrified, apathetic, self-conscious as I'm sure many of us are, if we can rise up out of our apathy enough to lift deliberate prayers to God about this, he will change our attitude, give us courage, whatever we need to open our mouths. We need to be deliberate in order to share the good news we know about Jesus, that he went on later this week to die on a cross to pay for our sins, and then was raised up from the dead 3 days later to give us life eternal. That's our good news. We speak it deliberately. Second stop, Luke 19, verse 39. We're in Luke, the rest of the sermon. So if your Bible's open, turn there, Luke 19. Picture the scene. All these people and disciples of Jesus spreading cloaks, cutting branches, shouting Hosanna. An air of celebration. They're shouting out a message of good news. But as with any celebration, there are naysayers. Like at football games. Massive spectators all cheering for the home team. And for some crazy reason, a fan away from the home team, or the away team, I should say, got his ticket, who knows how he got it, right in the middle of all the home team fans. He sticks out like a sore thumb. He's wearing the wrong colors. Whenever he stands up to cheer, he stays seated. And when he jumps up to cheer, everyone around him scowls at him. I don't know. It'd be like a guy, let's just call him Arnie. And he's all decked out in green and white, sitting amongst all the Michigan maize and blue fans. Cheering at the wrong time. He's staying sad and seated when everyone else around him is happy and high-fiving. He's a naysayer in that section. Pretty soon people are telling him, well, just go home. They're spilling pop on him, throwing French fries at him. This Arnie would want to throw French fries at me right now. And I love you, brother. Go blue. There are naysayers. There are naysayers. Pharisees. Pharisees in this story, when Jesus entered Jerusalem. Verse 39, they say, teacher, rebuke your disciples. They don't like what's going on. Don't like the commotion. But mostly, they don't like the message being shouted. Messiah on the way. Hosanna. Hosanna to the king. They don't like it because it's a controversial message. Perhaps that's one of the reasons we freeze up today. The message, too controversial. No one wants to hear about a Savior who died on a cross for our sins. You calling me a sinner? You're so judgmental. What a hater you are. So much opposition to that kind of message. Too controversial. What's the application? You could write down, so what, or too bad, but a nicer way to say it, everyone likes nice, is this, be bold. Be bold. So what if it's controversial? Too bad. So what if it's someone rolls their eyes at you? Too bad. Be bold. So what if someone thinks you're stupid for believing in a Savior? Too bad. Did you hear what Jesus said to the Pharisees, verse 40? He boldly answers them. I tell you, if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out. What an answer. Imagine it today. Don't roll your eyes at me. I've got to tell you this because if I don't, see those stones over there? They'll tell you. It's that important. Important enough for me to be bold. Third stop, Luke 19, verse 37. You see a whole bunch of excited people. Listen, when Jesus came near the place where the road goes down the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began what? Joyfully to praise God in loud voices for all the miracles they had seen. Listen to that loud, joyful praise to God. Can you hear it? The message is not just controversial. No, it's an exciting message too. It's a message that brings joy. The people are filled with joy in their hearts. lifting up joyful praise to their Messiah. They're sure of it. It's an exciting message for them, for us too. You know the message. Sure you do. You and I and every human being who ever walked this earth except Jesus have sinned against God. The punishment for sin, according to God, who created us, he ought to know, the sentence for even one sin against him, and we have all sinned at least once, probably once per month, once per week. Someone even said once, actually, we increase our guilt every single day because we sin over and over and over again. But even if it were only once, we are guilty in God's eyes. Guilty people, when it comes to an infinite God, receive an infinite punishment for their sin. The Bible calls it hell, where sinners, you and me, and everyone else, will be punished with no possibility of an end to that punishment. It's eternal. The agony of hell is not a quick couple seconds, or 10 minutes, or a day or two, or even a 20-year sentence. It's a life sentence. And when that comes around, a life sentence means forever. Forever tormented, suffering in hell for your sin. Forever. Let that sink in. That's the bad news of our message. Here's the good. It's exciting. Jesus, the Messiah, took on the punishment for all our sins. Took that punishment upon himself, paid for it all. He endured an eternal hell punishment as he hung on the cross for you and me. He endured it all. It would have taken eternally forever for us, but because Jesus is fully God too, he got it done for us on a single Friday as he was crucified on a cross. Now the best part. He tells you, you are pardoned because of what I did. And he offers that gift of pardon to us. And all we have to do is say, yes, I accept. I want it. And for the rest of my life, I live to thank you and to do what you tell me to do and follow you, Jesus. It's a message brimming over with excitement, filling us with joy. Because you couldn't do that. Get yourself pardoned like that. But Jesus did. No wonder we gather, want to praise Jesus. No wonder our children stand up front and praise Jesus. No wonder five young people will stand up and say, we want our lives from now on to praise Jesus. We're excited about what he's done for us. It's an exciting message. What's the application? Be encouraging. If something we said, a message we spoke, good news about Jesus we told someone gives them joy and excitement in their lives, then be encouraging. Be thrilled and rejoice with them, encouraging them any way you can. Worship with them, study the Bible with them, pray with them, share a wow with them about what God is doing in their lives. In any way you can, encourage them. If they have responded to the exciting message you shared with them, encourage them in their excitement and joy. But back up. Back up a few steps. Maybe you haven't shared that good news yet. How can you be encouraging? Simple. Invite them here. Invite them to a church service. Easter Sunday, of all things, next week. Invite them to church. To the people. The people are the church, of course. Not a building, first of all. Encourage them with an invitation. Have you anywhere to go next Sunday morning? Come to our Easter service. Encourage them to. What you got going on next weekend? Easter egg hunt for the kids Saturday? Cool. What about Sunday morning? Encourage them to come. I'll pick you up. I think you'll like it. I'll sit with you. It's pretty exciting. Good news, great joy, fills me with joy. Encourage someone with an invitation to church. Maybe that's where be encouraging starts for each of us. Hey, it's Easter Sunday. You coming? I'll drive. Fourth stop, last one this morning, Luke 19, verse 40. I tell you, Jesus replied, if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out. There it is. What a powerful message. Even stones long to cry it out. The stones are longing for every last Christian to be quiet so they can start telling the message. That's how powerful it is. Even stones want to cry it out if we don't. Application, be there. God help us, let us be there. Let us speak it when it needs to be spoken. If even stones know the power of the gospel message and desire to cry it out, then what, may I ask, is wrong with us? What keeps us from being there with the most powerful message in the world on our lips? What keeps us from being there? If they keep quiet, the stones will cry out. Wow! If we have a be-there frame of mind for those who need to hear the message of Jesus, we won't have to worry about those stones. As much as the stones want to cry out, and they're everywhere, God wants even more to have us, the ones he's already blessed with good news, God wants us to be there. God will supply the power from his message. Let him worry about that, supplying the power. We just need to be there. Speak up, not keep quiet. When my wife and I go for walks, we'll take turns kicking a stone down the road. She gives it a good kick, and then it's my turn to kick it as best I can in front of her. We do this a few times, back and forth, until the stone hooks into a ditch or slices off into someone's yard. That's us, beloved. No, that's us, beloved. God wants us to give those stones a good kick, because we're there now, and we get to speak up. That's who God wants. He wants us to be there, to speak his powerful message of good news about Jesus. He wants us to be there. All right, four more tonight. Four more tonight. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, thank you for the message. It is good news, the greatest news ever. Captivate us by it, like we've never been captivated before by it, so that, well, we will be there, and we will be bold. And we will be deliberate. Put that in us. Put that boldness in us. We don't want the stones to have to do it. Help us to be the ones to do it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, friends in Christ, what a great day it is. Always a joy for the church to hear believers profess their faith in Jesus Christ, in the Lord Jesus Christ, their Savior. A couple weeks back, several of our young people, Seth DeYoung and Hope Gritter and Kate Eisenhoff, Adam Vanderhart and Luke Vanderhart, they all went before our elders and they professed their faith. They were interviewed by our elders and we heard their testimonies with joy that day, their testimonies of faith in Jesus. And now together, we as the entire congregation have the privilege now in worship to celebrate also their professions of faith in Christ. And since Kate Eisenhoff has not been baptized in the past, he will also be baptized this morning, so we'll witness the sacrament of baptism as well administered to him. So I'd like to invite those five up here at this time, Seth and Hope and Cade, Adam and Luke, if you could come up, just find a place on that first step there so we can all see who you are. Well, today we are rejoicing with you, so you got to smile now, okay? I told them I would help them smile, so smile big. It's a wonderful day in your life here. We're rejoicing with you and your families, of course, in what the Lord Jesus Christ has been doing in your life, and so we give praise to God. And you perhaps already have read part of their testimonies, congregation, in the bulletin of the last few pages, except for that blank page, but their testimonies are in there. Take some time and read those as well when you have a chance. And now I'm going to ask you to respond to your vows, the following questions. So you ready for this? First question, do you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, sent to redeem the world? And do you love and trust him as your Savior and with repentance and joy embrace him as Lord of your life? And second question, do you believe that the Bible is the Word of God and it reveals Christ and his redemption to you and that the confessions of this church faithfully reflect the revelation of God's Word? And third, do you promise to do all you can with the help of the Holy Spirit to strengthen your love and commitment to Christ by sharing faithfully in the life of the church, submitting to its authority, and you join with the people of God in doing the work of the Lord everywhere? And then fourth, do you accept the gracious promises of God that were sealed to you in your baptism, and do you affirm your union with Christ, which your baptism signifies, or for Cade will shortly signify? Seth DeYoung, what is your answer?
I do.
And Hope Gritter, what is your answer?
I do.
And Luke Vanderhart, what is your answer?
I do.
And Adam Vanderhart, what is your answer?
I do.
And Cade Eisenhoff, what is your answer?
I do.
And so in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, I now welcome you to all the privileges of full communion. I welcome you to full participation in the life of the church. I welcome you to its responsibilities, its joys, and its sufferings too. Receive this blessing now. May the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, may he equip you with everything good for doing his will, and may he work in us that which is pleasing to him. Through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Let all God's people say,
amen. Amen.
So welcome, friends, and we're going to have you back up here in just a moment. We have to do the baptism first, so you can head back. We're not going to applaud or anything yet. We'll save that for later, okay? So just head back to your seats or right up here. That's fine. And so, beloved, as we now prepare for Cade's baptism, listen to these words of Christ who instituted this sacrament of baptism. Our Lord said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." This is a command from God. And in obedience to Christ, the church baptizes believers. and their children. In baptism, God confirms certain promises to us. First, a promise he made to Abraham and all his descendants. I will establish my covenant as an everlasting covenant between me and you and your descendants after you for the generations to come to be your God and the God of your descendants after you. And second, a renewal of that promise in the book of Jeremiah took place, that God will put his law on our minds and write it on our hearts, that he will be our God and we shall be his people, and that he will forgive our wickedness and remember our sin no more. And third, a fulfillment of that promise in the coming of Jesus Christ, who gave pardon and peace through the covenantal blood of the cross that was poured out for the forgiveness of sins. And fourth, in anticipation of the final fulfillment of those promises, with a look forward to heaven, the Apostle Paul assures us, if we died with him, we will also live with him. If we endure, we'll also reign with him. These are promises that are unfailing, for God gives them to us. Now, the Bible instructs us that the water of baptism signifies the washing away of our sin by the blood of Christ and the renewal of our lives by the Holy Spirit. It signifies that we are buried with Christ, that we're now dead to sin. And it signifies that we're raised with Christ as well, that we are alive to the new life of walking with Jesus Christ. In other words, we are adopted as God's own children. That water of baptism signifies and seals those promises that God makes to us in baptism. He calls us to put our trust in him for life and death, put our trust in Christ, our Savior, to deny ourselves, take up our cross, and follow him in obedience and love. It's fitting that we go to our God as we prepare. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, we pray that you will never destroy us in our sin as with the flood, but save us as you saved believing Noah and his family, and spare us as you spared the Israelites who walked safely through the sea. We pray that Christ, who went down into the Jordan and came up to receive the Spirit, who sank deep into death and was raised up Lord of life, will always keep us in the grip of his hand. We pray, O Holy Father, that your Spirit will separate us from sin and openly mark us with a faith that can stand the light of day and endure the dark of night. Prepare us now, O Lord, to respond with glad hope to your promises so that we may drink deeply from the well of living water. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So, Kate, if you could come back up at this time, meet me up here at the font. Just stand right here, if you would. Now, Kate, before I baptize you, I ask you, do you desire to be baptized in the name of the triune God? And will you receive that baptism as a sign and seal that God accepts you in Christ, forgives all your sins, and grafts you into his body, the church? Kate Eisenhoff, what is your answer?
I do, wholeheartedly.
So I'm going to just have you kneel maybe just a little bit here. So Cade Raymond Eisenhoff, I baptize you into the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Stay here, Kate. So we got to get your compatriots back up here too, okay? So just stand right here, stay here. And so the rest of you, why don't you come on up, and we'll keep going here. Congregation needs to see you again, because we're going to ask them a vow in a moment as well. So you are seeing your brothers and sister in Jesus Christ, friends. And so I'm going to ask you your response to the grace of God today in bringing Cade and Seth, Hope and Adam and Luke to faith in Jesus Christ, and in grafting them in to Christ's body, the church, and specifically into our congregation. And so I'll ask for your response to the promise of God given to Cade in his baptism, and as well as a promise related to the professions of faith. If you would respond to the next question with, "We do, God helping us," okay? So do you, the people of the Lord, promise to receive in love Cade and Seth and Hope and Adam and Luke and into our fellowship as members of the body of Christ? And do you promise to encourage them in the Christian faith and help them in the work of the Lord and doing that work everywhere? What is your answer? We do, God helping us. And now we can even do a standing ovation for God at this time. Okay, let's stand. Friends, that is the praise that we bring, not for these five, and they know that. It's praise for what God has done in their lives, right? What an incredible thing. We give praise to God. We're going to sing in just a moment the blessing, and then I'll offer a blessing after that as well. Okay, so let's sing together. Beloved church, before we close, I want to offer you God's blessing as well. We've sung it, but now we're going to hear it spoken as well. Right after that, there'll be just a moment of silence or two so that the professors of their faith could quick go out and head downstairs. There's a reception downstairs. That's where we'll be meeting them, as well as the Parcells family, if they could let them squeak out too during that moment of silence. Receive now God's blessing. God go before you to lead you. God go behind you to protect you. And God go beneath you to support you. And God go beside you to befriend you. Do not be afraid. The blessing of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be upon you. Do not be afraid. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.